actually on the list. And I think we've got about a minute's amount of time.
So, and we have got a, so a lot, we've got time for questions. And I've got another question, which was about the, this one. You said that they can follow up or they can find topics that they're interested in. Are those, are topics that they're interested in? So if they, but are these in response to the first article that you had? Then they find something within that article that is like, oh, I'm interested in this, so I found that piece in the bibliography.
Or post this every alternate week, I ask them to post something they're interested in. Yeah.
That's right.
And what is germane to the chapters we're talking about. So for the special relativity chapter, I want them to find an experimental article on ions in some accelerator in Germany that's actually testing decay rates with ion tons, stuff like that.
Do you find that they, like, one person will post something and there will be like a group gloms around them, and like, oh, that is really cool, and then they all start to post on, like,
yes,
does the course ever go in a direction that you did not expect?
Yeah, well, yes and no, since I'm not directing where they go, but they do self-direct it. Some of the articles are, like, boring. Someone will post some, math student will post some crazy thing on string theory, and everyone will go, like, I can't even read the symbols here, right? So that one doesn't get a lot of comments. I don't do a, there is facility for ranking popular and stuff like that. I haven't leveraged that in the teaching, which would be, is a really good thing to do, is what common, you know, what's the most popular article? How do I get mounting points for attracting other people? And the more comments on my thread, the greater a person I am and the higher grade. I haven't done anything like that. Questions from people here?
Do you have directions on what you shared with the students and how to do this?
This is it.
So you just share this presentation with them?
Oh, for the students.
Yeah.
Oh, no, there's, yeah, there's lengthy directions for students. That's all hosted on E2L and so on. So they know what's required of them. And they can, the specific requirements are embedded in the rubric and that's accessible to them through E2L. So they can go and check off for themselves and do it in their Google assessment.
Would you be willing to share those, like, as a model, the directions and rubric with us?
Sure, absolutely. I just pulled those off the web from mostly from a K-12 site.
Awesome.
And then modified them for my purposes. You can find rubrics used. I mean, it's the only, it's such an expedient way to do grading. If you're in K-12 mass mark, high throughput grading, you have to do that.
Right. So we'll put those on the after teaching webpage for the for Diigo.
Are you using the instructor console in Diigo at all, or are you?
I'm not sure what the instructor console is.
Okay, it's an area where you can, where you actually can upload your students to a specific group and watch them, what they're doing through the console. Or I guess you're not, because you don't know
enough. I don't know what you're talking about, surprisingly, because unless it's been something that's been added on recently. There is a, you manage it, as an instructor, you if you start the group and you manage it, you can manage the members, you can look at, you can click on a member and see how many things they submitted, that sort of information. So if that's what you're
referring
to, yeah, I do that. That could be much more highly developed. Mm-hmm. Diigo could develop that much better, but, and this is what distinguishes Diigo. If you're, say, a Mendeley, which is a citation oriented thing, and it does allow commenting. It's not set up for groups, and it's not set up to manage the comments and things like that. Oh, there's another thing, as you can see, this is a report, so it sends out reports, and you can get a list of everything. That, they aren't necessarily what you exactly want, but you can get all the information out of Google.
So when you started with looking into Delicious and Diigo and some of the others, were you thinking immediately that you wanted something as a group, or did you start off with like using it for yourself and then sharing it with a few colleagues and then being like, wow, I could use this for my class?
I played around with some questions, how did you arrive at this, I think. I've played around with citation management and stuff for years and found them all kind of inadequate. And then every few years I have another charge at it. and see what's out there and click on this. And I just said, this is perfect for class. I'm going to try this in class. Now I use this in garage physics, which is a whole other enterprise for students. I use it in my own research group. So when I find articles on studying dark matter, the dark matter group, and my dark matter researchers are in that, and we plunk stuff up on our dark matter group. So I use it for that too.
So how many groups are you in right now?
Well, I have groups for my classes, but only a handful for myself. But the point I'm making is you can actually use this for yourself if you want to. And so in many ways, it's superior to Mendeley, for example, if any of you can map a site you like or something, which has some automated features. It's actually superior.
Does it create the references for you, bibliography, basically?
And does it does not work like a citation in professionals. Does it?
Yeah, like
a nice select, Chicago style all the time. No, it doesn't do that. That's not its orientation. It's not a citation.
So a lot of times when you look at a third-party tool, like something outside of the learning management system, you're attracted to the functionality of it, but then there's some compromises as far as workflow goes. It's a little clunkier a lot of times, where people don't necessarily want to manage all of that and getting students out and back and getting grades and comments or whatever you need to administer. Do you have any thoughts about that, how simple it's been, how complicated it's been? If you had a class of 100 rather than 42, would it be different?
There, on the number, there is a question there, so I thought it was a limit of 50 that they were giving me, but I've had more than 50 students, so I don't know what in a class, so I don't know how. As far as registration, this is not. Got a really nice integration with an LMS, so I just asked students to join and use their WISC ID, WISC email address,
okay.
And then I just check them off, just to keep any hackers out. That's all I do. So no, it's not as convenient. Like all these things, doesn't have that automatic registration and drop feature, which would be great. So I would love to see this integrated into. To D2L, for example, on Canvas, like Piazza is. I think this is something to look at for people who are academic technology.
So I'm curious here, because it seems like the main functionality is snagging a link and then commenting on the link. What functionality does this provide beyond what Moodle and D2L and other learning management systems do if the student were to just post a link in the discussion forum and then have the active?
All this stuff's about pain. Every click costs you 90% of your customers. This is one click. And the bookmark thing does it. You're reading the thing, click it, boom, it's all filled out for you. The link, the comment, that box comes up. You just add your thing, hit boom, and you're done. So if you were to implement something like this in a discussion group, it's well. Right? So you can do it. Right? So you ask students to go find things, and then you have to, now I'm reading a paper, now what do I do? Highlight, cut, and paste the URL, wander over to D2L, go down to my discussion thing, find a thread, take it in there, right? Then get into the discussion thing and try to type some comment. Right? It's painful. But what's cool about what makes this work, and like all things in technology, is ease of use. That's the crucial thing. No, there's great functionality here, but that's great, but if great functionality that you can't access easily is useless. What's cool about this is that bookmark touch. It's the really coolest thing. Plug it in your browser, and boom, you're done. So if we had such a thing, implementation, and you plunked it, it did all this and it dumped it into D2L, that would be fantastic, right? But also, anything you do, if you're working on a Canvas project, right? Anything you do to make that easier for the students. So you're not wandering around some monstrous LMS trying to figure out how to get stuff done.
I'm asking as a devil's advocate, because I actually use a bookmarklet-based reference manager that allows collaboration.
Yeah, which one?
Picker Pile?
Yeah. Oh, actually, I'm not familiar with that one.
Oh, that's great. They're new kids on the scene.
Yeah, no, I'm sure. That's why I review it every 2 years.
Exactly.
I go back and I finally look at it all over again because I want the functionality from this. Oh, yeah. So I'll look at it. Was it good?
You actually have to pay for it, so that would be a significant barrier in your class, but it's called Paper Pile.
Paper Pile, yeah. Yes?
You talked about Diigo, the Skyping board, and the Piazza, and the Diigo. Basically, to me, it's like we are all discussion, collaborative discussions. And this one has the advantage of bookmarking, you know, the ease of use. And you also mentioned the Piazza integrate with DL more easily. So what's the advantage of Diigo over
Piazza?
Yeah.
Well, I actually use Piazza too. What's cool about Piazza is it supports LaTeX. So I can do, students can do comments in beautiful math.
Okay.
So I use that. And that's all integrated in with their exercises and stuff about their academic physics aspects. So I use that. What's the advantage? I mean, so this does the things I've talked about this is set up to do the bookmarking type of one. Piazza doesn't do that, it's just a discussion forum. So Piazza is a better discussion forum than the B2L discussion forum, but it has similar functionality. But the killer app for that, for me, why I use Piazza is it supports a lot. That's cool.
So it's better for citations? And
this is better for citations, yeah. Piazza doesn't do any of that citation stuff. It's just for posting questions and comments and threading, stuff like that. It's a hyped up version of what's available in D2L. It's just better in many ways. And through its user interface, it's a lot easier. It sends the emails out just like this does. So when someone posts a Piazza, I get an email. And I can, as an instructor, choose to respond or not, or say, go ask a student. But I get that constant notification, which is really important to stay in touch with students. That's another feature that I really like. We should probably get well